I might just kick off. I'll do a very quick introduction to everyone. Obviously, thank you all for joining us at today's briefing session. Today, you're going to hear from Mike Abed, who is going to take you through a quick overview of the industry and talk a little about the customer drivers for our announcement today around adaptive networks. And then you will also hear from Sanjay Nayak, who will detail the solution and provide some colour and detail around that. We've got about an hour for this session, so we're looking to break it into two components. Half an hour will be presentations from Mike and Sanjay, and then 30 minutes we'll do a Q&A session. Q&A is obviously across teams. It might be a little clunky, so apologies in advance, but just from a housekeeping perspective, what I'd like to do is obviously if we can keep everyone that's not speaking on mute throughout the session, certainly whilst we're hearing from Mike and Sanjay. And then the Q&A, will open the mics up at 11 o'clock. And what we'll do is I will moderate that session. So if you can click on the hands up symbol that sits within Teams if you wish to ask a question, or you can message us in the thread of this call to say that you'd like to ask a question. I will introduce each of you by name. If you can then just say the publication you're representing, ask your questions. Try to keep the questions to one or two in a block. Obviously, we've got half an hour for Q&A. We'd like to give everyone the opportunity to ask their questions. I'm not going to steal any thunder from Mike or from Sanjay, so I might hand across. Welcome you all again and thank you. And Mike, over to you.
Thank you, Steve. And good morning, everybody. And thank you for joining us this morning. It's great that you can be with us and cover what we think is a pretty exciting announcement. Let me start by just talking a little bit about why we're doing what we're doing today and start by talking a little bit about our customer environments and our enterprise customer environments, because we believe that they have been going through significant change over the last couple of years, particularly over the last sort of 18 months or so, where they've had a massive shift in change. Operating in the cloud has pretty much become essential for so many businesses. And they're also grappling, I guess, with the acceleration that we need to do in every part of our customers' organizations. Work, of course, is no longer a place that we used to remember. Today's flexible hybrid workforce really does rely on cloud applications, video conferencing, storage, no matter where we all are working from. Many of us today obviously all working from literally around the country. You just heard Steve talking about he's in the bush. So work is no longer just a place. And so to meet the needs of our businesses, I think, the future of enterprise networking has to be built on hybrid software-defined solutions over a broad and powerful, reliable, secure connectivity options. And that's what we're all about. Everything we do at Telstra Enterprise, from providing connectivity to helping customers migrate their applications to the cloud through, say, Telstra Purple, providing security and unified collaboration tools and services, we've got to ensure that our customers' applications work seamlessly. And of course, right now, the market is also changing enormously as well. Right across data and IP market, we're seeing a once in a decade, technology shift. I believe that this change that we're announcing today is certainly bigger than a G generational shift when we went from 3G to 4G to 5G. This is pretty significant because of three factors, really. Firstly, networks and connectivity is increasingly becoming very, very competitive in the market. Secondly, we know that software-defined networking or, wide area networks, SD-WAN, is making it a lot easier to manage and scale networks, giving customers really good visibility, control, and flexibility in their own networks. And thirdly, as I mentioned through the customer lens, we've seen an enormous amount of growth of cloud-based applications across our networks and services, software as a service growth as well in our networks. And this is all driving enormous bandwidth demand across our networks, and the move to hybrid networking is absolutely essential as well. So with a large number of SD-WAN vendors and partners that are in the market at the moment, we're really seeing a lot of fragmentation in the market that is making it hard for our enterprise customers to really decide how to navigate all those options. And certainly what customers are relying on Telstra a hell of a lot more for is to be able to bring that all together, bring our experience from working with a couple of key vendors and partners to just provide them a workable solution that is easy for them to understand and implement into their network environments. The other thing that we're seeing a lot this year is that, of course, COVID has really highlighted how critical networks are for business success. You know, we saw the scramble and the shift to moving entire businesses to remote working almost overnight over that middle weekend in March. It's absolutely necessitated the flexibility for so many of our enterprise customers with higher levels of scrutiny, security, performance and reliability in their networks as well. And I think for all of us, as we get used to the new normal, how businesses will operate in the future, how customers are looking to transform their own networks, the one thing that they all want right now, given the uncertainty that we've got in business, is flexibility on how they manage their networks. So to address these changing needs of our own customer needs, but also the changing market dynamics with technology that I just outlined, we've been working on how do we transform our own data and IP portfolio and change the way business customers think about their data connectivity. Right now, today, we have a very fixed and arguably inflexible IPVPN and MPLS services and connectivity that are effectively bundled for our enterprise customers. And I'm really excited and pleased today to launch what we believe is the next era of networking for our customers that we've named Adaptive Networks. And what we're effectively doing is we're unbundling our services to give our customers choice, flexibility, much more simplified pricing, and amazingly, no locking contracts for most of our services. Adaptive Networks is the new network solutions category for Telstra. I'll emphasize that this is a multi-year program. We're going to be iteratively releasing new products and services to our enterprise customers over the next couple of years. Our Adaptive Network products and services are also designed to take advantage of the NBN and price competitively. So where we've already got deployed a Telstra fiber solution for our enterprise customers, that will remain the number one choice for us, obviously, but we can optimize the best hybrid network for our customers as well. We need to look at what our customer outcomes are and give them the best solution and offer that flexibility of what this change really, really does. Now, Sanjay is going to take us through the key elements of what Adaptive Networks is all about. But there's three key elements that we're going to talk about today: adaptive connectivity, adaptive SD-WAN, and adaptive core networks. So just before I hand over to Sanjay, I guess, you know, the key messages for me really is that we have tested this along the way. We've been working on it for the best part of the last year. We've involved quite a few of our key customers and business partners that help us go to market. And I have to say the response has been overwhelming. Otherwise, of course, we wouldn't be taking it to market. So we're really excited about the response that we've had. Customers have been delighted and frankly surprised at just how flexible that we're being with our products, because we've traditionally been pretty inflexible in how we bundle our services. So we know that it's going to be well received in the market. We've really pushed ourselves at Telstra to not only disrupt ourselves, but we believe this is going to disrupt the market and really change how connectivity is thought of and bought by a lot of enterprise customers. Our driving force, of course, in doing all this was putting our enterprise customers first, making sure that we were giving them choice and flexibility and simplicity, given the uncertainty that we all have in the business environments today. So I think, really, this is a really exciting to be on the front foot in this big generational shift. And there's no doubt that I think this is a significant change, because connectivity has not changed for the best part of the last two decades. And this is a big change in how businesses consume connectivity. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Sanjay to take us through the technical details of those three elements, and I'll come back for Q&A after that. Thanks, Sanjay. Take it away.
Thank you, Mike, and good morning, everyone. So as Mike mentioned, my name is Sanjay. I lead the Global Connectivity and Platforms product groups at Telstra. And really, this includes all of our network connectivity products, software-defined capabilities, cloud, and managed services that are aimed at customers in Australia and internationally. So I'm going to cover off three main topics today within adaptive networks, which is our category of network connectivity solutions. The first one I'll talk about is adaptive connectivity. And what you're seeing on the screen is really a reflection and a representation of where we have been in the past and where we are moving to in the future. So there are two key areas of change that make adaptive connectivity very, very compelling. The first is we're unbundling our product constructs, where we completely move away from rigid, multi-year, complex to lifecycle propositions. With adaptive connectivity, we will enable our customers to be able to choose the underlying fiber access service independent of the connectivity that sits on top. And what this allows is the ability to flex between a public internet service and a private IP VPN network on a single Telstra fiber access service to meet their application needs. So this really makes it easy for our customers to then be able to, you know, mix and match different types of access from Telstra and NBN to create the hybrid networks that drive increased resilience, diversity, but also an ability to move applications to the right type of connectivity and network services. So that's number one. The second element of adaptive connectivity is the commercial flexibility we can now offer. So this starts with our customers now being able to sign up for month-by-month contracts for adaptive network service components. We will continue to offer term contracts should our customers need it, but with increased flexibility as more service components, you know, move within the contracted term. So if a customer does want to sign up for a multi-year term, that is available, but we give them continued flexibility to be able to add services, move services, you know, within that contract term. Now, aside from a few exceptions, customers on adaptive network contracts will not be required to pay an early termination charge when they choose to increase, decrease, or even cancel their services with Telstra. Now, in addition to the contractual elements, we have also simplified our pricing. And each of the components of what adaptive networks offers has been rationalized, simplified, and we've also simplified our discounting structures so that our customers can really easily understand the end-to-end commercial offer. And, you know, as they need to change to address COVID or other situations, they're able to do so in a more predictable, easy manner than they have had in the past. So our belief and the reason for why we're doing all this is we want our customers to stay with us because they value the services we offer, but not because of the underlying contract. So that's a really big shift for us as we think about connectivity services. So in phase one of adaptive connectivity, which is launching today, it includes Telstra's fiber access service, private networks, which is our MPLS IPVPN services, and it includes a range of internet services, which is our premium Telstra Internet Direct product. It also includes our Internet Direct Lite product, which is, you know, a contended service compared to the premium service. And we will be introducing NBN options into the adaptive connectivity category in December. Next year, we will also add Telstra 4G and 5G mobile integration into adaptive networks. And this will introduce enterprise-grade rapid start connectivity. What that really means, guys, is it takes time. If a customer premise does not have a fiber service, it takes time for a fiber service from Telstra or NBN to get connected. With 4G and 5G, they can get a site rapidly connected and business can start operating while the fiber, underlying fiber does come back and connect. And then once the fiber is connected, that same service can then be used to boost the overall resiliency that we offer to our customers, right? So rapid activation, pivoting to a backup service if that's what the customer wants to do. And in addition to that, we will offer wireless-only solutions as well for really the smaller branch sites where a wireless solution is more appropriate compared to a fixed service. So that's a little bit about the shift around adaptive connectivity. Now, let me walk you through in the next slide what this actually means for our customers in their journey towards adaptive connectivity and adaptive SD-WAN. So in the past, customer networks were designed to a very static state. So this worked really well when applications were hosted on-premise, they were managed either by the customer or by a partner. You know, changes within the network environment were quite infrequent. And hence, there was a lot of stability and staticness in the nature of the networks. But the challenge that we face today and going forward is, you know, in those kind of product constructs, it's really not possible to pivot and change the underlying connectivity to the dynamic business needs, to work really well with cloud applications, to be able to react to COVID-19 and other such global events. So with adaptive connectivity, what we're showing here now is an example of how a customer could run their applications dynamically on a single Telstra fiber service across both public and private networks. So as long as the fiber service is dimensioned appropriately, customers can allocate and change their connectivity bandwidth to suit their application needs. These changes can be executed fast as customers on a month-by-month contract can do so without consideration of early termination fees. They have predictable service component pricing available for them at all times and a much simpler contracting framework. Now, adaptive connectivity independently is quite powerful, but it also creates the foundation for transition to SD-WAN, and we call this adaptive SD-WAN. Now, there are a number of SD-WAN technologies out there, but we've decided that we want to curate industry's leading SD-WAN technologies from Cisco and VMware as the core part of our SD-WAN proposition today. Now, that does not mean we won't add more in the future, but those are the ones we absolutely have a lot of experience in. You know, we've deployed thousands of sites for our customers in Australia and globally, and we've learned a lot. And it is these learnings that our customers really value as they transition from an MPLS environment to an SD-WAN environment. Now, we don't stop there. So typically, when you think about SD-WAN, it's deployed as an overlay technology, which means it sits on top of a network connectivity service, which we call the underlay, right? So SD-WAN is the overlay, network connectivity is the underlay. With adaptive SD-WAN, we're actually bringing the overlay and the underlay closer together because we believe that it drives improved application outcomes for our customers. We do this by including smart integration of the SD-WAN overlay and the Telstra network underlay by deploying gateways into the Telstra core network. And this really enables fluid routing of cloud applications. If we can route it better, performance increases. Now, in addition to that, we have also been automating the end-to-end operational environment so that we can offer improved onboarding, deployment, and support ongoing use experiences as employees within a customer organization start to use these services. Now, Telstra's agile delivery model also enables continuous introduction of new features and automation capabilities that will bring through life through our ongoing investments, not just in adaptive connectivity and adaptive SD-WAN, but also in 5G, our artificial intelligence, machine learning, edge compute, and cybersecurity products, right? So end of the day, it's a holistic solution that really helps our customers achieve their business goals. And finally, it's all about the rich professional services that are offered by Telstra Purple and our partner ecosystems that really bring, you know, to our customers the expertise and the experience to help transform their application and network environments that ultimately drives business outcomes. So when we combine adaptive connectivity and adaptive SD-WAN, we're excited to offer our customers the flexibility, the agility, the choice that they need to transition from the old to new next generation hybrid networks and be able to manage the overall risk through that transition with an outcome that drives an improved application outcome for their employees. Now, all of this is possible because of our investment in our core networks, which we call adaptive core networks, right? So let me talk a little bit about the investments that we're making into the core network that really allow us to bring to life connectivity and SD-WAN in an adaptive manner. So since the second half of FY20, we've been making significant improvements across our optical and mobile core. We continue to transform our core networks to web-scale technologies such as closed-loop automation, software-defined orchestration, separation of the user and control plane, and making the network more consumable via APIs. And team, this is really important because what it does is the more programmatic you make the network, it allows us to better manage the overall operation outcome of the network, right? So our networks are designed to operate at traffic peaks. And because of this investment, we're able to detect the latency of packets on the network. We're able to reroute traffic across geo-diverse paths. And ultimately, from a customer perspective, it allows us to offer almost six nines of availability. Now, we back that up with our ISO 27001 certifications, which really give our customers the peace of mind, you know, that they're working with a partner that has got the capability and the overall operating environment that, you know, will enable the applications to work in a more resilient manner. Now, with orchestration capability and the exposure of network services, what we're able to do is connect these customer networks to cloud and different SaaS providers. Now, that is really important because it really bridges the gap between applications that are hosted in a cloud versus an enterprise network. And we do that by being able to spin up connectivity to over 170 cloud providers globally, over 35 data centers that we have deployed globally. Now, that's a key ask from our customers because they want to make sure that when COVID-19 hit, employees are still able to access their applications, even though they were not able to get into the office. Look, in addition to that, you know, we've got a lot of integration with, you know, our hyperscaler partners. So you think about the ecosystem of the AWS, the Azure. You know, we've got dedicated network connectivity slices, you know, for large enterprise customers can use to deliver differentiated quality of services on an end-to-end basis. We have invested in additional resiliency. So, for example, we've now got three pads connecting our intercapital networks across the country with layer zero control plane capability. And what that really allows is for us to be able to build another path when one is lost due to a fiber or an equipment failure in minutes, rather than, you know, trying to do it within hours and days that it would take traditionally. Now, yesterday you would have seen a little bit of an announcement around 400 gig wavelengths. Now, again, that's, you know, another investment that has started to, you know, bear fruit for us, where we're able to increase the overall network capacity to 400 gig wavelengths across both metro and regional optical networks. And we're in the process of actually trialing 800 gigs at the moment, right? Our investments in our mobile core have started with the deployment of containerized 5G dual mode core that supports, you know, 5G, NSA, and 4G. We're trialing 800 millimeter wave radio services, and we've actually got a speed record there of 4 gigs download with a 200 meg upload record there, right? So there's a lot of investment that's happening in the mobile core, not just the fixed environments. And really, it's those two environments that are really coming together in a single integrated control stack that allows us to reduce any complexity, lower our transport costs, be more competitive in the market, and ultimately offer improved availability and resiliency to our customers. So guys, three main components. Adaptive connectivity is what we're taking to market. Adaptive SD-WAN is helping customers transition to next generation hybrid networking, and it's our investment in the core network that brings it all together. So let me stop there, and I'll hand it back to Mike.
Thank you, Sanjay. You know, I love working with Sanjay because he's able to take really complex enterprise environments and explain it really simply. So thank you for that, Sanjay. That was very clear. As Sanjay said, you know, this is a multi-year program that is really the next era of connectivity for our customers, and we've got a lot more to come in the next little while. So adaptive networks really is all about setting Telstra up for the next decade or so. And I have to say that, you know, we've launched this next phase or this first phase of adaptive networks to deliver that unprecedented level of flexibility for our Telstra Enterprise customers. So in summary, let me just say that, you know, what we're seeing is demand for bandwidth has never been greater. And absolutely, the importance of powerful, reliable core networks has never been more important to deliver that seamless digital experience that all of us employees and our enterprise customers and their customers expect from our enterprise customers here at Telstra. And that's why we have transformed our data and IP portfolio, not only disrupting ourselves, but we believe this will change the market as well. And we're super excited to be able to bring this to our customers today. And I think it's really going to set us up for long-term success as well. So thank you for hearing us out and covering this for us today. It's super important for our customers and hopefully your readers as well. And so I'm going to hand over to Steve now to facilitate our Q&A.
Thank you, Mike. And thank you, Sanjay, for the outline of the program. Happy to say that we will share those slides. Obviously, it's a highly technical announcement that we're making today. So we'll share those slides with you all to assist with reporting. We'll now move to Q&A. We are bang on time, which is great. Actually, we are a minute and a half early. So congratulations, Mike and Sanjay, for doing that for us. We'll now move to Q&A. If possible, if you've got questions to ask, at the top bar of the Teams chat, there is a hand symbol. If you click on that hand symbol, it will raise your hand. You can either raise your hand and we can come to you to ask those questions. I'll just come through to you each in order. Or alternatively, you can message me. There is a messaging chat, which is next to the hand, and you can say you wish to ask a question and we can facilitate it that way. When you do ask your question, if you can just introduce yourself and let Mike and Sanjay know your publication and then fire away with your questions. We've got around half an hour, so let's use this time well if we can. I'm not seeing any hands just yet, so I'm not sure if someone...
Super clear, Steve.
Pardon me?
Super clear, no questions.
No questions. We've made it so clear. It's fantastic. So if there are some questions... And now it's time to kick off. So I'm not sure who would like to put their hand up first. It's now that nervous moment where we sit here and wait.
It's all right. If I know anything about journalists, Steve, they're not shy. Come on.
No, generally not. Surely there's one there. Simon, maybe you've got a question for us. I'm not sure. I'm going to drop you in it. We really are all silent. Graham Lynch. All right, Graham, Dave, we'll come to you.
Okay, can you hear me? Can you hear me there?
We can.
You can, okay, great. Okay, my question is, it's not what Telstra is. So it has quite a large footprint of customers and activity internationally. So I guess I was looking for a bit of colour around how global this announcement is, and is it being positioned the same way to your customers in Asia and North America as it is here in Australia?
Thanks for the question, Graham. Absolutely. I mean, Telstra, one of its best-kept secrets is our international business, but it is a $2 billion business, and we are operating in about 20 countries at the moment. So it is a pretty big footprint. A lot of people also don't understand or don't know that Telstra carries about 35-40% of all of Asia's data traffic across our subsea cables. So we're a pretty big player in the international and particularly in Asia, across Asia market. In terms of this announcement, it's obviously for our domestic footprint initially, but we're certainly providing connectivity for a lot of our international customers as well, and providing SD-WAN solutions and layers as well. But Sanjay, do you want to talk about the next layer, particularly for our international, maybe a little bit about our programmable networks, which allows customers to manage their traffic across different cables and different networks across the globe?
Yeah, very happy to. So before I get to Telstra programmable network, specifically on adaptive networks and the proposition and the category of services that we're talking about today, a lot of the principles around which we have built adaptive networks is actually available for our international customers today. So, you know, what we're working through right now as a product team is working with our customers internationally to really go and test which one of these principles we need to augment further. What are the gaps in the international segment in our product set, because, you know, Australia operates in a certain way, in 20 other markets internationally, there are 20 other operating models. So we've got to make sure that we've really understood that. But that is work that's heavily underway, and we expect to, you know, make further announcements on this in due course. Telstra Programmable Network, which is, you know, a service that allows for automated connectivity for our customers, is available, as I said, to over 170 different service providers globally, and really, you know, serves three main use cases. One is I have two data centers. I want to be able to interconnect those two data centers, and I want to be able to do it in minutes, and I want to be able to select the different types of speeds and performance. And that's what that particular use case, you know, allows customers to do pretty much in, you know, in minutes. So they set up a network, they deploy it, off they go. The second use case for us is cloud connectivity. And this is where we spoke about, you know, a customer's existing enterprise network needing to connect securely to the different cloud providers. And again, the service is, you know, literally can be designed by a network engineer, and they have direct access into our core networks to be able to programmatically, you know, set up those kind of services. And the third one is more about secure internet access. And so, you know, as these applications start to live more and more in the clouds, you know, the breakout points in the network start to become increasingly diverse across the geography. But as that internet access point starts to become geographically diverse, the threat level also increases. So secure internet access, where customers are able to not just spin up the connectivity, but add on top a security service, you know, from a Palo Alto or a Checkpoint or one of the other leading security vendors out there, is an automated capability that is available. So Telstra Programmable Network is a really core part of everything we do. In fact, we're looking to, you know, make the programmability deeper with all of the other investments that we spoke about. So a lot of work underway. International, big focus. We want to make sure that we bring the right proposition in due course.
Does that cover it for you, Graham?
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you. Mike and Sanjay, we've got a question from the chat. Thank you, Simon. Sorry to put you on the spot before. You've actually fed one into the chat for us. Simon is from Comstar as well. His question is, what does this do for enterprise MPLS services? Is it a managed decline business now, given SD-WAN can be delivered without MPLS as an underlay?
Yeah, so maybe I'll take that, Mike, and if you want to add some color to that. So the question is a really good one, because our customers, you know, consider MPLS for certain types of applications that MPLS as a service continues to be relevant. And SD-WAN, as you know, can accept both MPLS as well as internet access services. So when we think about the different customer network topologies that we absolutely support, MPLS, internet access, feeding into SD-WAN, and bridging the gap between the overlay and the underlay becomes absolutely critical. Now, as you know, the trend of customers moving from MPLS to SD-WAN is absolutely there. We've embraced it, which is why we're investing all of our efforts into SD-WAN. We've believed that there's a lot of value for us to help our customers transition from the old to SD-WAN-based networks, and that's what we're gearing up to do for our customers through adaptive networks.
And definitely, you know, MPLS is still has a very strong use case for a lot of our customers, particularly in head offices and major data centers, etc. So it's definitely not going away, to your question, Simon.
Thank you for that, Simon. I'll take it that has adequately addressed your question, which is good. Yes, it has. There we go. You've messaged me. Look at this. Technology working at its best. We don't have any more questions in the chat channel, and I can't see anyone's hand up aside from Graham, who's probably still excited from his first question, I think. Unless you've got a no follow-up. There we go. Problem solved. Thanks, Graham. Last round, if anyone does have any further follow-up questions, obviously we have provided you the release, which does outline the core information that we have touched on today. Mike and Sanjay have obviously added some color to that, and we will provide the slides to you to assist with reporting. Graham, you're back. That's good. I'll get to you in one moment. We also are recording this session, as I noted yesterday in the invitation, so we can provide that recording to you as well, but I imagine most of you will have recorded it yourselves for the purpose of reporting. Graham, we'll come back to you for your question. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I'm assuming you can hear me again with all these mute and unmute controls. I guess I've got a question around the no contract promise. When you play in the enterprise market, you have to make some quite deep investments in fiber to get to end customers. And even if you're using an NBN service, they have certain expectations around customer commitment at 3 to 5 years and so on. So I just want to get a feel for the risk that's been taken on here from Telstra. You know, in that traditionally business providers do for that 3 to 5 year commitment.
Yeah.
When they build infrastructure.
Yeah, thanks, Graham. It's a really important element of what we're announcing today, because traditionally in the enterprise space, you're right, customers generally sign up 2, 3, sometimes 7, 8 year contracts. And like all of us, even from a consumer perspective, nobody likes to feel that they're locked in, that they're trapped, that they don't have a choice. And we want to really stand behind our services and our product and make sure that our customers are with us because of our services, our reliable networks, not because we've got handcuffs on them for contracts. And we believe that this will actually build a lot of loyalty, and customers will appreciate that, so that they're actually with us for the right reason. So yes, it's a big shift, and that's part of my thinking, in that it will change how customers see us as a flexible partner in what they have to do. As their businesses change, we need to be able to allow them to change their networks as well. So where there's, say, a big investment in a fiber build, we will contract with a customer with that separately. But for the access and the connectivity layers, we don't believe that we need to contract for long periods of time with our customers for that. So if I can use a consumer example, Graham, in the way that now in our business, if you buy a mobile phone, you might have a contract to pay that off, but your services are separate from that. And if you change your services, you're still committed to paying off the contract. Now, increasingly, customers aren't paying for fiber bills for smaller tails, et cetera. It's just for those big, complex networks where that might happen. But otherwise, particularly if you're already a Telstra fiber customer, which we have thousands of Australian businesses as our fiber customers today, the build is already there. And so we're happy to provide those services at no lock-in contracts going forward.
Thank you.
Anything you want to add to that, Sanjay?
No, I think you've covered that well. Thank you, Mike.
It's pretty radical, Graham.
Yeah, yes, it is very radical. It's not really heard of before.
It's not. And when we tested it with our customers, it's in my opening remarks, I commented about the feedback that we were getting from customers is, wow, you know, we're so used to being locked in. This is amazing flexibility, which we will value. And so we put the customer at the front of everything that we thought of in this to make sure it was as easy as possible and as flexible as possible for our enterprise customers, because we are in a very competitive landscape. And I certainly want our customers to be with us for the right reasons, not because we've contracted them in for a long time.
That's great. Thank you, Mike. And thank you, Graham, for the questions. I'll do a last call on questions. And if not, we can actually give everyone a little bit of time back in their diaries, which I know, given everyone's schedules, is unbelievably valuable at this time. So any last questions from any of the media? If not, I'll just wrap
thank
up by
again,
saying
everybody.
Thank you very much. Yeah, for joining us. Sorry, Mike, I just cut you off there. Thank you for joining us.
Okay. We're both going to thank everybody for joining us. It's okay.
Yes, and thank you all for taking the time. Please remember that we do have an embargo on the media release for 2 p.m. today. If there are any questions, feel free to contact me via mobile or email, and we will come back to you with answers to anything that that maybe tweaks your thoughts post-event. But do have a great day, and thanks for joining us.